It's honored to present here to share my concept and understanding of the blockchain. My background, I used to be a lawyer, and 5 years ago, I started my own company, a P2P platform in China called Dianrong. Right now, it's a leading P2P platform in China, and we closed the sixth round of funding, and we are the unicorn company. And today, is my role is the chairman of the China Blockchain Application and Research Center. So this is a non-profit institute to promote blockchain. And we founded 2 years ago, which ICO is not that popular as today. So my sharing today is towards the consensus. And I will start from this page and from this guy. It's a CZ. If you know the ICO very well, this is one of the most biggest exchange in the world called Binance. And this is the founder. I can remember, record 10 months ago when I entering their company in Shanghai, a small office. It's a midnight, 24th PM. And more than 20 engineers still working on coding. And they just launched their website 1 month ago from the, June. And when I talked to him, I asked with their valuation, because I'm the investor. I want to invest in their exchange. He said, our valuation is right now is 1.5 billion RMB. Just after 1 month, they launched their website. And I said, OK, I heard that Sequoia, just to give you the term sheet, the valuation just 500 million RMB. Why you increased 1 billion just after 1 week? They said, because our coins valuable. Right now, the valuation of our coins is 1.5 billion. So that's what happened in China. And after several months, you can see he's on the homepage of the Forbes. I think it's one of the fastest one, and the entrepreneur can be on the homepage of the Forbes. So, what's concerned the China government, and we can, everybody knows, last September, the China banned the ICO and the closed exchange of the Bitcoin in China. And when I start my company in China about P2P business, it's almost similar. More and more big platform like Yizhubao, everybody heard before. So it's more than 60 billion RMB's case. And just last month, April in Shanghai, another 660 billion RMB cases happened in Shanghai also. It's a P2P platform, which illegal fundraising case in China. So the Chinese government always concerned about the publicity and the stability. So they don't want the people, the consumer, buy some products and come back to pursue the government, ask for the money back. So I can understand very well. So not only P2P, blockchain, Bitcoin, but all the innovation of the fintech, they have the almost similar fate. Just like payment, you know, 2004, we have the third-party payment like Alipay. They running the business without any license even more than 7 years, and P2P more than 9 years without any license. So the government need time to understand the new technology like peer-to-peer lending, like blockchain, give them time and give them patience. So after last September, more and more popular star in China, token economy, they came out of the China because of the pressure, based on the pressure of the government. They come to Silicon Valley. Some of you may understand and can may know the people on this page. I don't tell the exact name of him. And I can see in front of him a few months ago, some foreigner, some local American, a white hair a man, bring the white paper to that guy and ask for how to issue the coin, how to running the successful the ICO. So after they running out of China, they figured out that, oh, the Chinese government pushed us out and opened another door for us. And we are really superstar here, and we can run the good business here, and even better than China. So just 1 month ago, the Bitcoin's price going down, and everybody think, wow, it's the end of the world. Maybe the cryptocurrency economy will crash. But after 1 month, today, we can see the booming up of the new Bitcoin price, and everybody think, well, it's the brilliant future of the cryptocurrency. So pricing can change our attitude, even can change our belief. In China, we call it 三根阳线改变信仰. So Spring Festival, we can see our most popular WeChat group in China. We call it 三点钟, 3 a.m. clock group. So right now, the WeChat group named the 三点钟 3 o'clock more than 20,000. And last month, I visited Macau, the offline activity of the 3 a.m. group. They have the more than 3,000 audience in Macau, and they sell the first line seats more than 750,000 for one seat, the price, RMB. And they also sold more than 100 membership for different city, and the price charge more than 225,000 per city. So they make tons of money. So this is what we can see, that hot, that popular in China about ICO, about coin, but nothing related about blockchain. So we are coming, and this is the picture. This January, we founded this new organization, and this is in Switzerland. Well, we are supported by the government, which want to be the bridge of between a regulator and industry. We try to explain to both what is the real blockchain, and the hardest part for the consensus between regulatory and industry is that token necessary to the blockchain? So this is confused the regulator a lot. They said, if you develop the blockchain technology, we will 100% support you. Why you want to and issue the coins? Is that necessary? So this is an open question for everyone. That's what we did. We have some internal seminar between the regulators and industry. And just what we did 5 years ago when we running P2P business. And when we started a business like P2P, without any license, without regulations, and we approach the regulator and tell them, come to visit us, I will show you what's the real peer-to-peer business, lending business. And we invite them, the regulator, to be our team member to do the research and the wrote book about internet finance, about fintech, what happened in US, what happened in UK, and we translate all the regulations from English to Chinese and help them to understand. And after almost 2 years, and in 2016, then we have our first version of the regulation about the peer-to-peer lending. So this is the difference between blockchain entrepreneur and when we started the peer-to-peer lending. And right now you can see some blockchain entrepreneurs, they are still feel should be stay away from the regulator. They are scared about the regulator. To be honest, if you want to succeed in some innovation in technology and fintech, you should have the sense how to approach the regulator. So in this internal seminar, we can see also the big difference between the regulator and, or not regulator, in this internal seminar, some traditional investor, a really popular one, I don't tell the exact name, he still insists on that blockchain with ICO is criminal. blockchain without ICO is nothing. So this is a traditional common sense from the investor brain. But still, we can see some entrepreneurs in blockchain, they give a lot of explanation why the token is necessary to the blockchain. So I think things like that is the right way to reach the consensus. So last month, I also be in Silicon Valley. I'm in the presenter of the Tim Draper's event. And on this event, he announced that in 4 years, we can see the Bitcoin reached $250,000. That's which it makes all the audience excited. So what's the attitude from the different country? It's really interesting. I visited Vietnam in the last month. I visited Vietnam and Singapore and Japan. And different attitude. In Japan, the government think the big company like Sony, you should never issue the coins. But for small media enterprise, you are welcome. You can apply for the IPO application and wait for the final approval. And 2 weeks ago, when I visited Vietnam, the Communist Young Legal, the chairman of the Communist Young Legal, he gave the presentation and he said, well, even the some fake case, just like 660 million US dollars case happened, but we still insist on for use for young generation. Maybe the ICO is a good way for fundraising for small startup companies. So everybody knows in China and in Vietnam, so in the developing companies, fundraising for startup companies always the problem. So ICO just gives them a chance to fundraising. So right now we can see the recovery in the market give birth to the next round of opportunities, but it still have a lot of problems. So the latest statement of Chinese government, we can see in different province, in Beijing, Shanghai, Guizhou, Jiangxi, Shenzhen, they are all have the policies, new policies for promoting blockchain. And in Hangzhou, we can see even they announced the 10 billion fund for blockchain. And in Beijing, we will announce the next month, we call the blockchain fund without any coins. So this is from the government sense. They said, we still promote blockchain technology, but please be away from the ICOs. So what is the consensus? I don't think consensus means no difference. I think the consensus means seeking the common points while reserving the difference. So which block the blockchain develop in our mind is we call the common sense. So still, we should give the space, give the time for the new technology, and try to get everyone on the one page and really reach the consensus. Thank you for your time.
Very interesting overview. On the question of using a coin or not, are you talking about in the context of an ICO, or would a utility token as part of a infrastructure ecosystem for blockchain be something that would also be frowned upon? If you understand, not as a fundraising tool, but in terms of what in Beijing the government is saying right now, because this is obviously an important detail.
Yes, so in the government point of view, they think any coin is really close to the finance. And the finance is really under the strong and strictly control of the government. And they don't want to touch any coins when you develop blockchain. And for my own point of view, I think the coin for the public chain like Nubers, I think it's a right incentive system for the ecosystem, whole ecosystem. I think it's necessary, but today I think it's still impossible
But I still remember that the popular saying, impossible is nothing, and maybe for the future.
Can you talk a little bit about how you differentiate between blockchain versus coin? Because there seems to be a lot of overlap and interchangeable use. So use of blockchain specifically to secure an activity versus use of coin or issuing a token. Thank you.
And everybody knows the Bitcoin happened first, then the blockchain. So we just take the blockchain concept from the Bitcoin and use it as a distributed system. So I think the blockchain, in some government regulators' mind, is a technology, can share information, it's secured, and use the coding, and they think that's all. And even in the Hapledger IBM system, they still can develop the blockchain without any coins. So that's the difference, I think, between Bitcoin and the blockchain. It's not only in China government. They think, yes, blockchain is a good technology which can build up the infrastructure for finance or digital assets. But the coin is something like, just like a pawn scheme.
Hi, yeah, it's here. So two things I wanted to get your thoughts on it. Since you're in China a lot, so I also get contact by a lot of Chinese ICO companies. Some of them already ICO'd. And so I'm curious to understand what's the current dynamic within China for those companies that's already ICO'd last year. How many of them, you know, I know a lot of them has moving out of China already, right? So what happened? Can you share some of that? And then the second part of this is, let's say there's still a, you know, a company that's set up their entities outside China, and they go to China to fundraise and talk about what's the situation under that circumstance. Is the government doing a lot of control or crackdown and all that?
Two good signals. One is that you can see on the newspaper, I think it's 1 week ago, maybe, and central government announced that non-risk in ICO and Bitcoin in China, they think it's they can stop any real actions about ICOs. So that is also a signal that say, okay, let it be. We are almost done. So it's I think it's maybe a good sign to the entrepreneur. And for the fundraising in China, I think institutional investment, I think it's not banned. And because it's a qualified investors, they can be responsible for themselves. Just as I said in my presentation, and just for the individual investors without any common sense of finance risk, this is the, what government want to protect. They want to protect them and ask them to stay away from the ICOs. But still, right now, they are observing what will happen in this industry.